Do you like a good sneaker? How about a waterproof boot in the fall or winter? Well, Vessi is the best of both worlds, giving your feet unparalleled comfort and dryness, regardless of the conditions outside. Now, here's some of you saying, yeah, okay, I've tried water-resistant shoes before, Simon. But Vessi is not just water-resistant. These are legitimately waterproof tennis shoes. It's an easy-to-clean shoe, sustainably made from this stuff called Dymatex, which is a really comfortable knit shoe that keeps you warm in the winter and cool in the summer. Wear them out in a downpour, jump through puddles, wear them out to run errands in the snow. They are super reliable, they also look super normal, not like some weird super waterproof hiking shoe. In short, Vessi make the perfect front door shoe, ready and waiting for you whenever you need them. Vessi actually sent me some new shoes, which I have here. These look fantastic. Never worn these. However, these they sent me about 18 months ago, and I was always a boot person. Like, I always just generally trended towards leather shoes, and I was like, I'm not really a sneakers person. Vessi sent these to me. And basically worn nothing else for the last 18 months. And these somehow still waterproof. I assume that the waterproofness is something that'd be like, oh yeah, it's impressive at the beginning, and then it sort of goes away after 2 weeks. But no, these are still, I went and put my feet under a fountain in the park to test it a few weeks ago. Totally works. Then there's the new ones also, wearing them right now, just because I literally wear nothing else. I'm totally off the talking points here, but yeah, I just wear Vessi's. They could also make a perfect gift, but I wouldn't do that. I would just keep it for yourself. Head to Vessi.com and grab yourself a pair, or just follow the link in the description below. And now today's video. In the late 1940s and early 1950s, the United States was gripped by a veritable flying saucer mania. Following the alleged crash of an alien spacecraft near Roswell, New Mexico in July 1947, sightings of flying saucers, mysterious lights, and other UFOs exploded across the country. As we covered in our previous video, the top secret Cold War project behind the Roswell incident, most of these sightings later turned out to be secret US Air Force spy balloons, though some have speculated that more advanced experimental aircraft may have been involved. Indeed, in the late 1950s, the US Air Force did actually try to develop its own flying saucer. Had it worked, this bizarre but innovative aircraft developed in cooperation with Canada may very well have revolutionized aerial warfare. This is the story of the Avro Canada VZ9AV Avrocar. The introduction of nuclear weapons instantly changed the face of modern warfare. In the early days of the Cold War, military strategists predicted that the majority of airfields would be destroyed within the first few hours of a nuclear exchange. Considerable energy was thus devoted to developing aircraft which could take off and land vertically, allowing them to operate from unprepared fields. The complex technical challenges involved attracted an entire generation of talented designers, including a young English aeronautical engineer named John Carver Meadows, or Jack Frost. Born in Walton-upon-Thames in 1915, Frost was introduced to aviation at the age of 15 when his high school Latin teacher took him for a flight in his biplane. After graduating from St. Edward's School, Oxford, with honors in mathematics, chemistry, and physics, Frost worked for the aircraft firms Airspeed, Mars, Westland, Blackburn, and Slingsby, designing the Slingsby Hengist assault glider for the British Army and a unique inflatable landing bag system for gliders. In 1942, Frost joined the famous de Havilland Aircraft Company, quickly making his name by designing the flap systems for the DH-103 Hornet and the DH-100 Vampire, Britain's second ever fighter jet. After the war, Frost was assigned to an even more exciting project, the DH-106 Comet, which in 1949 would become the world's first operational jet airliner. Early in the project, engineers considered giving the airliner a radical tailless configuration with sharply swept wings and no horizontal stabilizer, and Frost was tasked with developing a smaller testbed aircraft to investigate the aerodynamics of such a design. The result, created by mating a vampire fuselage to a new tail and wings, was the DH-108 Swallow, which on September 9, 1948, became the first British aircraft to break the sound barrier. Unfortunately, the Swallow proved dangerously unstable, and all three prototypes were lost to fatal accidents, one which killed test pilot Geoffrey de Havilland Jr., son of the company's founder. In 1947, Frost and his wife Joan emigrated to Canada to escape the privations of post-war Britain. There, John found work as an engineer at AV Ro Canada Limited, better known as Avro. Starting life as a wartime aircraft factory producing Lancaster heavy bombers, by the late 1940s, Avro had become a hotbed of aerospace innovation, responsible for nearly 70% of all aviation development in Canada. On his arrival, Frost was assigned to work on the CF-100 Canuck, Canada's first, and thus far only, indigenously designed and built jet fighter. Tasked with improving the aircraft's aerodynamics, Frost initially attempted to change the CF-100's conventional straight wings to a more efficient swept back configuration, but government pressure to get the aircraft into production limited him to making more minor improvements. Frost was unimpressed with the final result, calling the aircraft a clumsy thing, all brute force. Even worse, test flights with Frost aboard revealed some structural problems with the CF-100's main wing spars, causing significant delays as Frost worked to correct these issues. Government officials blamed Frost for these delays, resulting in friction within the design team. Frost coped with these stresses by tinkering with various advanced design ideas in his spare time, including a helicopter powered by rotor tip jets and an innovative concept for a vertical takeoff and landing, or VTOL, aircraft, which was to obsess him for more than a decade. Frost had long considered the design of early jet engines to be unacceptably inefficient and sought to develop a more elegant alternative. He eventually came up with an unusual design wherein the flame cans, which burned fuel and air and produced the hot, high-pressure gas that powered the engine, were arranged around a specially designed compressor and turbine-like spokes on the wheel, creating a large disc-shaped contraption he dubbed the Pancake Engine. But while theoretically simpler and more efficient than contemporary jet engines, the Pancake Engine was bulky and difficult to fit into a conventional aircraft, while the engine's thrust emerged in all directions rather than rearward, as required to propel a vehicle forward. Frost thus designed a strange craft shaped like the blade of a giant spade, with a pointed nose, straight wings, and the circular engine in the middle. Curved ducts with a complex system of flaps redirected the engine's thrust in any direction, allowing the aircraft to take off and land vertically, as well as fly forward at high speeds. Frost dubbed this strange craft the Avro Ace, after the Ace of Spades, which it vaguely resembled. Thankfully for Frost, he was soon removed from the CF-100 project, allowing him to set up a special projects group to pursue his innovative design concepts. In 1952, the Canadian Defense Research Board assigned Frost Special Projects Group $400,000 to develop his Avro Ace concept, now designated Project Y. By 1954, the SPG succeeded in building a full-scale wooden mock-up of the Project Y vehicle, though by this time Frost had come up with a new, even more promising concept. While working on the CF-100, Frost had become fascinated by an aerodynamic phenomenon known as the Coanda effect. Named after Romanian aerodynamics pioneer Henri Coanda, the Coanda effect describes the tendency of a stream of fluid to cling and follow the curve of a solid surface. For example, it is the Coanda effect which allows a ping pong ball to be levitated above a vertically held hairdryer. In 1951, Frost approached Bob Johnson, a machine shop superintendent at Avro, with a drawing of a small disc-shaped device, 9 centimeters in diameter, with a rotor in the center powered by compressed air. Though convinced that the pressure of the CF-100 was getting to Frost's head, Johnson nonetheless manufactured the prototype, which Frost used to conduct a series of experiments where he ran compressed air through the model and measured the downward thrust produced by the rotor. On one occasion, he even succeeded in making the little disc fly across the worktop. Based on these experiments, Frost designed a large disc-shaped craft with a central turbine driven by multiple jet engines. Via the Coanda effect, this turbine would force a curtain of air around and beneath the craft, lifting it off the ground. The turbine thrust could also be redirected through a series of ducts and flaps arranged around the circumference of the disc, allowing it to be flown in any direction. The circular shape even offered a potential solution to one of the most vexing problems of aircraft design, creating a wing that works well at both low and high speeds. Generating lift at low speeds requires a thick, highly curved wing. However, at high speeds, such a wing produces an enormous amount of drag, making supersonic flight impossible. A disc-shaped wing is not particularly efficient at low speeds, but by diverting even a small amount of engine thrust over the disc, Frost could significantly increase its lift, essentially creating an infinitely variable virtual wing. Frost's system theoretically allowed for an aircraft which could perform equally well in hover, low speed, and supersonic flight, capabilities that would revolutionize aerial warfare. In August 1953, Frost took out U.S. patent number 376,320 on his air curtain lift discovery, sometimes known as the Frost effect. Unfortunately, difficulties with getting the original Project Y concept to work led to growing skepticism among Avro's directors, and in 1954, the Canadian government withdrew its support from the project and instructed Avro to focus on its more successful CF-100 and Orenda jet engine programs. In 1953, however, a group of U.S. defense experts visited Avro headquarters to inspect the CF-100. Frost proceeded to intercept the tour and reroute it to his special projects group, where he showed the officials the various mock-ups and wind tunnel models for the Project Y vehicle. The officials were impressed and recognized that Frost's ideas might provide the key to advanced VTOL aircraft that the US military was seeking for the anticipated nuclear battlefield. Different services, however, had different requirements. The Air Force wanted a supersonic-capable VTOL fighter, the Army a subsonic all-terrain vehicle for carrying troops and performing reconnaissance. Frost convinced the officials that his design could satisfy both requirements, and so in 1955, the US Air Force and Avro committed some $3 million to a joint development program, which was given various designations, including Project 1794, Weapon System 606A, and Project Silver Bug. The vehicle itself eventually became known as the VZ-9AV Avrocar. The Air Force's requirements for the Avrocar were extraordinarily ambitious, calling for a top speed of Mach 4, a ceiling of 30,500 meters, and a range of 1,600 kilometers. The Army's requirements, by contrast, were far more modest, calling for a vehicle capable of hovering a few meters off the ground and traveling 40 kilometers with a 500 kilogram payload. In addition to the Air Force's supersonic fighter and the Army's flying jeep, Frost envisions an Avro wagon for civilian use, an amphibious Avro Pelican for the Navy, and a scaled-up transport variant. But first, he had to prove the practicality of the air curtain system. After first constructing a wooden mock-up, Frost's team produced two full-scale prototypes, the first of which underwent wind tunnel testing at NASA's Ames Research Center starting in April 1960. Both craft consisted of a large aluminium-skinned disc 6.2 meters in diameter with a large turbo-rotor in the center, driven by three Continental J69 jet engines arranged in a triangle around the rim. A pilot and observer sat in twin bubble canopies on either side of the rotor well. The second prototype made its first tethered flight at Avro headquarters in Malton, Ontario on September 29, 1959, with test pilot Vladislav Spud Potocki at the controls. It would go on to make 32 more tethered flights before finally making its first free flight on December 5, 1959. Over the next 18 months, the Avrocar would accumulate approximately 75 hours of untethered flight time, making its final flight in June 1961. The results of these tests were, less than encouraging. For one thing, the heat from the three jet engines made the cockpit unbearably hot, forcing pilots to discard the canopy during flight tests. Even then, internal temperatures were so high that flight instruments were baked brown after only a handful of flights. But there were bigger, more fundamental problems. The air curtain lift system, the very heart of the design, proved far less efficient than Frost had predicted. Whereas helicopters produce lift over the engine areas swept by their rotors, the Avrocar only applied downward thrust over a relatively small area, severely limiting its lift capacity. Furthermore, the turbo rotor suffered from unforeseen inefficiencies, the thrust diverter ducts exhibited greater losses than anticipated, and the engines had a tendency to re-ingest their own exhaust, further decreasing the output and efficiency of the entire system. Worst of all, when the vehicle lifted more than a meter off the ground, it became dangerously unstable, exhibiting a violent rolling motion test pilot Spud Potocki aptly dubbed hubcapping. NASA Ames test pilot Fred Drinkwater III described flying the vehicle as like balancing on a beach ball. Frost had anticipated some of these issues and fitted the Avrocar with a semi-autonomic stability augmentation system to assist the pilot in controlling the craft, but this system proved woefully inadequate. Wind tunnel testing revealed the source of the problem. When hovering just above the ground, the Avrocar was supported on a large, stable cushion of trapped air. But when the vehicle rose higher, this cushion elongated into a tall, thin column, which became increasingly unstable with altitude. Frost attempted to fix this problem by drilling 52 vent holes in the bottom of the fuselage to help create a more stable air column, but this was unsuccessful. Another major problem was the diverter duct control system, which was designed to increase lift on one side of the aircraft and decrease it on the other. In practice, lift was decreased on both sides, causing the craft to lose altitude every time the controls were operated. No matter how much Frost and his team tweaked and improved the design, the results were always the same. In stark contrast to the Air Force's ambitious performance requirements, the Avrocar never managed to rise more than a meter off the ground or reach speeds of more than 56 kilometers an hour. Frost was nonetheless confident that the Avrocar would still meet the Army's requirements for a flying jeep and pitched an improved design with a large turbo rotor and aircraft-like tail to improve directional stability. By this time, however, the US military had lost interest in the project and it was cancelled in March 1961. What ultimately killed the Avro car, however, was the death of another, far more promising aircraft. Starting in 1952, Avro had been developing a replacement for the troubled CF-100 Canuck, the CF-105 Arrow. This powerful Mach 2 capable interceptor performed extremely well in testing, but due to political factors, which remain controversial to this day, on February 20, 1959, the Canadian government abruptly cancelled the program and ordered Avro to destroy all prototypes, tooling, and blueprints. This decision sent Avro into a tailspin, forcing it to lay off most of its 50,000 employees. But the Special Projects Group was retained, and the Avro car project limped along for another 2 years. Ultimately, however, Avro could not survive the cancellation of the Avro, and the company ceased operations on April the 30th, 1962. Many Avro engineers headed south to the United States, becoming key figures in the U.S. space program. Jack Frost, however, emigrated to New Zealand, enjoying a long and successful career in that country's aviation industry. He designed innovative air conditioning and cargo stowage systems for Air New Zealand, headed the certification of the Bennett PL-11 Airtuck, the first commercial aircraft designed and built in New Zealand, and even developed a human-powered aircraft with students from the University of Auckland. He died on October the 9th, 1979, at the age of 64. While the Avro car ultimately proved a technological dead end, efforts continued in several countries to develop a high-performance VTOL fighter. In the end, only three ever reached service: the Soviet Yakolev Yak-38 Forger, the British Hawker Siddeley Harrier, and the American Lockheed Martin F-35 Lightning II. All three, however, suffered from serious performance limitations, with only the F-35 being capable of supersonic flight and then only in short takeoff vertical landing, or STOVL, configuration. As the failure of the Avro car presaged, successfully combining VTOL capability with supersonic performance remains one of the greatest challenges in aerospace engineering. Today, both Avro car prototypes survive in museums, the first at the National Museum of the United States Air Force in Dayton, Ohio, the second at the U.S. Army Transport Museum in Fort Eustis, Virginia. These bizarre futuristic craft stand as silent testaments to a heady time when flying saucers were all the rage, Canada led the world in aerospace innovation, and the sky really was the limit. So I really hope you found today's video interesting. If you did, please do hit that thumbs up button below. Don't forget to subscribe, and as always, thank you for watching.